Hi guys, welcome back to the channel. I'm here again today with Dr. Kishan and we are going to be talking all about hair. Ooh, lush. Lush. Tell the guys at home, what's hair made of?
Hair's made of protein. It's the same protein that skin, claws, scales, keratin. So keratin's a really important protein. And you know, for protein, we need a good diet. We need all the raw materials to make keratin. But hair itself, most of it's actually dead. The only bit that's actually living is the bulb of the hair, which is sitting in the skin. As such, it's an appendage of the skin, but that's the only living part of it. And that's the bit that responds to some of the treatments that we do in the clinic. If you look at the hair structure, we've got a picture coming up. It's like a mini organ. It's surrounded by glands. It's subject to all sorts of hormonal changes, to blood flow, and it's got its own little muscles which makes each hair stand up on end. Hair can switch between different forms, such as the invisible or very fluffy vellus type hair, or it can be that hair that we see on our head, which is known as the terminal hair. We've got about 100,000 hairs on the scalp and another 50,000 on the body, and essentially it's that sort of remnants of when we were cavemen, when we'd have much more hair on our body to protect us from temperature changes.
Let's talk a bit, first of all, about vellus hair, which I know is probably not the topic that most people are tuning into this video to see. However, a lot of women, they have a problem with excessive vellus hair on the face or maybe even on the body.
Yeah.
Any tactics?
I mean, the usual treatments you can try, so, you know, home hair removal, lasers, quite a good option these days. We can prescribe product, it's a treatment called Vaniqua eflornithin, and that basically starves the hair bulb of the nutrients it needs to be produced, and that works really well actually in combination with laser as well. But sometimes that very fine vellus hair doesn't actually respond to laser, because laser relies on the pigment in the hair bulb. If you've got really fine blonde hair or blonde downy vellus hair, it doesn't respond well to laser, so Vaniqua can be a very good option. You just apply it every day on the skin. Like anything, hair goes through its different stages of growth. And the growth phase is the stage where most of our hair on our head is in at any one time. So 80 to 90% of our hairs are in the anagen phase. Anagen is the growth phase. You know, the base of the hair, the bulb, is got rapidly dividing cells. In the anagen phase, those cells are rapidly dividing. And that's why every month the hair is growing by about roughly a centimetre. That phase can last anywhere between 3 to 6 years, and it's pretty much genetically determined, and it can be modified with medications or some of the hair treatments that we give as well. But that length of the growth cycle kind of predetermines how long your hair can get to. After the growth phase, there is some sort of trigger or some signal that takes the hair into the resting phase. The resting phase is known as catagen. Suddenly the brakes go on, the cells are not allowed to divide anymore, everything stops, and the hair is just sitting there passively in the follicle. After that, the hair goes into telogen, which is basically the shedding phase. There's a fourth phase, which sometimes people talk about, called exogen, and that's where the hair physically falls out. But the interesting thing about these two last stages is there's a lot of overlap, and basically if you pull a hair on your scalp at that time, the hair will come out passively, it won't hurt. The reason why it's important to understand a little bit about the cycle of hair growth is that because it takes a while for the hair to go into different stages, it has an impact on the effectiveness or the timing of our treatment. So you might start a hair loss treatment now, but you might only see the benefits several months or sometimes even a year later.
A lot of patience needed for that.
Yeah. There's certain things like growth factors, IGF-1 or PGE-2, which stimulate the hair to go into the growth phase. And conversely, there are things such as stress levels, prolactin hormone, cortisol, that can stimulate the hair to go into the shedding phase or the telogen phase. Just things to be aware of. And we're going to touch on those in later videos.
So we've got a big old list of causes of hair loss.
Yep.
And what are the main ones?
So the main ones are androgenic alopecia, telogen effluvium or effluvium, and also alopecia areata. And most of our patients will come in and say, you know, I'm losing lots of hair, but actually you can lose up to 100 hairs a day, and that's still considered normal. Mm-hmm. It's when it goes beyond that, or when you start to see your scalp through your hair, that we might want to think about treating you.
Mm-hmm.
And we can obviously treat you preventatively as well.
So, you guys might think that male pattern baldness is the most common type of hair loss. However...
Well, I mean, it is, but it's the mechanism applies to both men and women. So you've got male pattern hair loss and female pattern hair loss. And the underlying mechanism is basically an imbalance in testosterone metabolism. So testosterone gets metabolized to dihydrotestosterone, DHT. And if that level of DHT is too high, and if it's unbalanced by the other hormones on the scalp, it can have a negative effect on the hair that we see on the scalp. So what it does, it converts the terminal hair into vellus hair. And if that level of DHT remains high, then unfortunately the vellus hair can itself become absolutely lost, and then it can be impossible or very, very difficult to reverse that hair loss. And although the underlying mechanism of androgenetic alopecia is the same, the pattern of hair loss in men and women is different. So in men, you get this focal hair loss, you know, at the temples and at the crown and the vertex. And in women, you get sort of a generalized, slightly more diffuse pattern of thinning across the scalp. But then you get this sort of visible scalp through the hair as well. And that's more common in women.
So it sounds like hormones are really important in hair loss.
If you're being subjected to lots of stress and you've got very high levels of cortisol, that also has an impact on hair loss as well. Melatonin, there's a real impact of hormonal health on the health of your hair.
Interesting. Is there a link with thyroid as well?
Yeah, so that is interesting actually, because overactive and underactive thyroid can cause hair loss. So that's something that we test for at the clinic as well.
So the next most common form of hair loss is effluvium.
Yeah. And effluvium is a beautiful name, isn't it?
It is.
Effluvium.
Just rolls off the tongue.
It does. And that one is basically where you're losing hair almost like a dog. You know, you're shedding hair everywhere. You know, it's on your pillow, it's on your brush, it's in the shower. It's everywhere. Sometimes you won't see the scalp through. You won't necessarily see a major difference in thinning on your scalp. But you see that the hair is being shed much more. The difference with this one is that it's usually caused by some sort of trigger. Now, the trigger is an abrupt change in your physiology. So it could be it's typically a huge stress, like a car accident, or maybe your parents are getting divorced, or some major stress that has a big impact on your life. What happens is that your body goes into this almost fight or flight, you know, survival mode. Yeah, survival mode. And unfortunately, hair growth isn't really crucial to being alive or surviving. So all the nutrients, all the things that support healthy hair growth are kind of diverted away to where it's needed. Actually, what I've seen is that people who try different diets, like, you know, there's extreme diets, or even if you adopt veganism, if you've been a meat eater, or the other way around, if you go from being a vegan to a paleo diet or something, that abrupt change, I've seen that also promotes effluvium as well.
Wow.
The interesting thing about effluvium is that once that change has happened, that big trigger's happened, that hair loss is seen many months later. And that's why we were talking about the cycle before.
Mm-hmm.
Because you might be an anagen, you have that car accident, or you change your diet, and then several months later, the hair is being shed.
So the third type that we're going to be talking about is alopecia areata.
Yeah. So this is where you see plaques of hair loss. It's quite common in young men and women. I think quite common in, a little bit more common in young men. Again, this is an interesting one because the underlying mechanism is autoimmunity. So it's basically your body fighting its own self. So the self being hair growth. So you get these patches of hair loss. The reassuring thing is that in the main, this problem is self-limiting and self-reversing. You can use treatments to improve the return of the hair, but it seems to get better on its own as well, but it just takes a bit longer.
Mm-hmm.
There are things you can do. You can use things like topical steroids or steroid injections, and even there's been some research to show that minoxidil and some of the other therapies we're going to talk about improve the hair growth as well, even in alopecia areata.
Okay guys, so that's it for this week. We hope that you've enjoyed the video. I'm sure you're all wondering, okay, that's great, what can we actually do for these types of hair loss? Well, worry no further, because we're going to be talking about that next week. So we will see you again then.